Worship Community Church, welcome to our online service this morning. We're so grateful that you can join us online. Thank you for joining us at 10 a.m. I know it's a little bit later for some folks that aren't used to it, but remember, we meet at 9 and 10:30 when the world is normal, if that's a thing anymore. So hopefully this is a little bit still somewhat similar to and familiar to us. I've got some announcements for us this morning. But first, I just want to take us through a little bit of the devotions I've been going through this week. And I've been reading through the book of Psalms. And Psalm 62, verses 5 to 8 says, "For God alone, O my soul, wait in silence, for my hope is in Him. He only is my rock, my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken. On God rests my salvation and my glory, my mighty rock. My refuge is in God. Trust in Him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before Him. God is a refuge for us."
I like that idea of God is a place where we can come and He is our comfort, but He's also... But it was great to see that something that has been worked on for a long time at this church, which is the updates to the kitchen, was passed by the membership. So we will be having some contractors coming in here over the next couple of weeks. And hopefully by the time we come back, you will all be able to see a brand new updated kitchen here in our building we're excited for. Next announcement is coming up on February 2nd. Pastor Byron is going to be leading a membership class online on Zoom. So if you're interested in joining our membership and having the ability to make decisions and vote on things like renovations around the church, we would welcome you out to that. You can contact the church or Pastor Byron for more information about that. Or if you have somebody that you would know that is part of the congregation that you would like to invite into that as well, just contact Pastor Byron or the office. Pastor Byron is also putting on his next set of Alpha series. That starts on February 10th. That is also going to be on Zoom. So if you know anybody who has questions about Christianity but doesn't feel for every reason coming into the church or joining us online for our services is something that they're comfortable with, this is a wonderful first step into the door about understanding more about Christ and Christianity. So if you know anybody who would be interested in that, you can point them towards our website. There'll be information for Alpha on there. Or you can, again, contact Pastor Byron. If you are wanting a Valentine's Day card from our children's ministry, Pastor Sarah is putting together little crafts from our children's ministry to go out to anybody who would like a Valentine's Day card this Valentine's Day. So if you would like one of those, contact Pastor Sarah or the office and get your name on the list, as those are going out fairly soon. And finally, coming up at the end of next month on February 25th, we're going to have our AGM. Just keep informed here on our website or from our announcements on Sunday on how exactly that's going to play out. Most likely it'll be on Zoom. We're excited to come together as a church and talk about the business of this coming year in 2021. So that's the announcements for today. I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to give it over to the band here, and they're going to lead us in worship. Father, we thank You that we can come together here this morning and to worship You. I pray that the meditations of our heart will be something that is glorious and pleasing to You, Father, as we come together online to meet with You. We pray these things in Your Son's name. Amen.
Stronger than the power of waters that never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love. Your love. Sing high, higher than the mountains that I face. Stronger than the power of the grave. You are constant in trial and the change. And it's one thing that remains. And it's one thing that remains.
Savior's robe as he walks into the room where people pray, where we hear praises he hears from. There is a sound I love to hear. The sound of the Savior's robe as he walks into the room where people pray, where we hear worship he hears from.
Surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies until all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God. From my mother's womb. You have chosen me. Oh, love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Oh, your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God. Oh, I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God. I'm no longer, oh, I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God. I'm stepping out of fear into the life you've given. I'm stepping out of fear and into the life you've given. Oh,
we just want to thank you this morning for your great love for us, that you sent your son, Jesus, to die for us and set us free from the sin that has held us captive. Father, as we come before you this morning, may we just lift you up and praise your name in our song, honor you in our words. May your Spirit speak to our hearts no matter where we are today. Help us to see this great man, Elijah, and how he struggled as we do, how we need to put our trust in you. We thank you for making a way for us to do that. We praise you this morning. We thank you. In your name we pray. Amen. Well, good morning, Friendship Community Church. I hope you are well. We have been praying for you as a church, and I want to remind you that if you need prayer, if you're going through a difficult time, give us a call, send an email. We have a separate email just for prayer. It's confidential. It goes to our prayer team, and they will lift you up in prayer, because we need each other. We need to lift each other up in prayer and to care for each other. So I want to encourage you to do that. We're going to talk about that today with our great prophet Elijah as well. We've been going through a series on 1 Kings 17 and 18 so far, and today we're going to start on chapter 19. And if you missed the last few weeks, go to our YouTube channel, our church channel, and in the live stream section there, you can find all of our services. And I encourage you to go, and if you missed the last few weeks, to go and watch the whole service and worship God along with us. But if you are short on time, maybe you've seen the service already live, and you just want to go and rewatch the sermon part. In the video description, there's a timestamp button, and you just click that, and it brings you right to the sermon, and you can get caught up in the series. We started off this series describing who Elijah was, what the political landscape was like, and we learned that the nation had gone through all kinds of problems since King David and Solomon, and there was infighting, the nation split, and there was civil war, and there was war with nations around them. There was all kinds of political trouble until King Ahab came along. And King Ahab married Jezebel, a princess of one of their potential opponents, so that they could have a political alliance and have some peace. And from the people's perspective, things had calmed down. There was stability. But from God's perspective, the nation was a disaster. They had walked away from Yahweh, the living God, and had brought in the worship of other gods, Baal and Asherah. And God had had enough. And so he brings in his prophet Elijah. And as we learn, we don't really know a lot about Elijah from before this. He was kind of from nowhere, and there wasn't a whole long history. But this was God's prophet, and he declares that there's no rain until I say. And so then we looked at Elijah learning to trust God in the valley, being fed by ravens, and then God bringing Elijah to a widow and providing for her, and then God raising the widow's son from the dead. And then last week we looked at the exciting part of Elijah challenging the prophets of Baal to a duel. 450 prophets to one, and their God against the living God. And Elijah ends up taunting them and mocking them, trash-talking them. And then when all of their efforts don't work, he restores the altar to God. And he calls upon God to show himself to the people. And God rains fire from heaven, consumes the sacrifice. And all of the people suddenly realize that Yahweh, the God of their ancestors, is the living God, the one true God that they should be worshiping. And they seize the false prophets and they put them to death. And it's clear that they need to stop worshiping these false gods and worship Yahweh alone, because then Elijah prays for rain, and the Lord brings the rain for the first time in over 3 years. And when we left off last week, it was like the typical place that most movies would end, right? When we watch a movie, we want it to end on the high note, right? At the climax of the story, and the prophet just rides off into the sunset, or in this case, the prophet runs ahead of the chariot to announce to the nation that God won the war, and the rains are coming, and the God of their forefathers is the one true living God. And we left off with this impression that Elijah is a man full of confidence in the Lord. He's full of swagger and power and perfectly trusts in God. I mean, a man who had the confidence to challenge 450 prophets, to challenge the king, to publicly put himself out there to trust God, would have full confidence in who God is, right? And that's the kind of people that we should strive for. And there were physical signs of raising a child from the dead and fire from heaven and rain, the ability to run before a chariot. This is a powerful prophet. Who could stop this prophet and the Lord that he serves? But the Bible is not written like a movie. It's written about real people. Real personalities with real struggles and real emotions. And as much as I loved last week and the power of God on full display, most of the time I identify with this week even more. And that's what I love about the Bible, because here you have this prophet of God. And for all the highs of Mount Carmel, we see this prophet go through an incredible low. And through it all, we see God caring for his prophet, no matter where he is. Elijah has spent a lot of time learning to trust God. And every time God was faithful. Every time God came through. And he learned that we can trust God. But sometimes we forget that, don't we? Even the prophet Elijah was human. He was an emotional person, just like us. Are we not emotional people? Sometimes even irrational people. And guess what? God's prophets were no different than you and I. And so we left off last week with this movie-like ending, right? God wins, and the people will surely come back to him, and King Ahab will surely see the power of God. It was right in front of him. He saw it with his own eyes, and surely he will be a righteous king and bring the people back to God. Even if you have tried to diversify and worship both the gods of your pagan wife and the gods of your ancestors, King Ahab, once you see the power of the living God, surely you'll turn back to him and worship him, right? I mean, how could you not? You saw the fire come from heaven. You saw the rain start. But the movie doesn't end there, because King Ahab goes home to his wife Jezebel. And this is 1 Kings 19, verse 1 to 3. Ahab told Jezebel everything that Elijah had done and how he had killed the prophets with the sword. So Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah, saying, "May the gods punish me and do so severely if I don't make your life like the life of one of them by this time tomorrow." Then Elijah became afraid and immediately ran for his life. Let's stop there for now and think about that for a moment. Elijah just stood toe-to-toe with Jezebel's prophets. 450 of them. Elijah just prayed and God sent fire from heaven. He just experienced the greatest victory for the Lord in generations. And now this one woman threatens his life. I would think that a hero who just called fire down from heaven and killed Jezebel's 450 prophets would have a little more attitude, right? The prophet that just trash-talked the prophets of Baal, would stand up and say, what are you going to do about it? Are you threatening me? Bring it on. I just held back the rain for 3 years. I just defeated your God and all of their prophets. What are you going to do about it? But you know, the deepest valleys are always between two mountains. The deepest valleys are always between two mountains. And we can never see clearly in the depth of the valley. When we come off of a spiritual high like Mount Carmel, we often go into a deep valley. We hit a dip in our emotional and spiritual life. And in a dip like this, we tend to lose perspective. We lose our bearings. And in the dip, sometimes we forget yesterday's mountaintops, because all we can see is today's valley. You know, if I'm honest with you, I know exactly how Elijah is feeling. I can't tell you how many times on a Sunday I preach my heart out, and every once in a while I'll knock one out of the park, and the Holy Spirit will move through the words that he's given me to say, and lives are impacted, and it's one of those wow Sundays, and you just feel the Spirit here working in people's lives, and oh, that was so cool. God is alive and moving here. And it was a God moment. And how amazing is the Lord? Praise Jesus. All the all-powerful living God is working through us. And so many times when that happens, I wake up Monday morning and start to think about how I'm going to word my resignation letter. Because all I can see is my own inadequacy. And all I can see is the challenges and the problems. And the things that I can't handle. And I can't even see God's mountaintop that happened just yesterday. Have you ever been there? Maybe you had a moment with God, a realization of who God is. Maybe God spoke to you through an event, through a reading, through a friend. You saw the power of God in your life and you were filled with awe and wonder and you thought, man, I will never doubt again. This is amazing. And then you wake up the next morning and all you can see is the valley that you're in. So here's our main point today. If you have a pen and some paper, you want to write this down because you need to remember it. And then we're going to look at the rest of the story. So here it is. When you hit the dip, stop digging. Trust God, because he wants to move you through this. When you hit the dip, the way out is to stop digging and start listening so that God can move you through this. We're not meant to set up camp there. We're meant to seek God through the valley. To trust him even in the darkness. So let's take a look at Elijah, because there are a lot of things that we can learn from him here. This is 1 Kings 19, verse 3 to 5. Then Elijah became afraid and immediately ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba that belonged to Judah, he left his servant there. But he went on a day's journey into the wilderness. He sat down under a broom tree and prayed that he might die. He said, I have had enough, Lord. Take my life, for I'm no better than my ancestors. And then he lay down and slept under the broom tree. Suddenly an angel touched him. The angel told him, get up and eat. So Elijah is scared for his life and he runs. He runs all the way to Beersheba, which is about 150 kilometers away from where he was at. Beersheba is the end of Israel. When the Bible talks about the span of Israel, it talks from Dan to Beersheba. And so Elijah is running, and he's running for his life. He's getting out of town. He's even getting out of the country. And we can see where he is. But yesterday, he was the most powerful man of God in Israel's history. And today, he's begging for God to take his life. I've had enough, Lord. I'm no know better than my ancestors. And we see that Elijah is in a deep valley because he can't even see the power of God yesterday. But we can understand the dip, and the dip is okay. Emotionally, we often feel the dip after an incredible high. I still remember an argument that I had with my wife the day after our wedding. If you're married, did that happen to you? You know, a wonderful day, and you get married, and then the next day, there's a dip. Maybe it's happened in something else in your life, a trip that you had highly anticipated, or an event that you had been planning, and it happens, and it's great, and then you get home the next day, and you just feel like you want to crawl under a rock and die. God intends for us to move through the dip. So we need to trust in Him, because every valley is between two mountains. We're not meant to live in the dip, but to move through it over the next mountaintop. But sometimes when we hit the dip, we start digging. We set up a permanent mailing address in the dip. But God means for us to move through the dip to the victory that's on the other side. But Elijah starts digging. And the first thing we see here is that he leaves his servant in Beersheba. When you're in the dip, it seems natural to isolate yourself. You want to be alone. But that's one of the worst things that we can do. We need to stop digging, because you need others around you to remind you of yesterday's victories, to remind you of the faithfulness of God. If you see someone in a dip, recognize it for what it is and go to them and encourage them and remind them of the victories of the Lord. Because when we isolate ourselves, we lose all perspective. But Elijah leaves his servant in Beersheba. He's running. He's scared. He's going the wrong way. What we need to see through this is God's response. Because even when his servant Elijah is running, having a faith crisis, take a look at God's response. This is 1 Kings 5, verse 8. And then he lay down and slept under the broom tree. Suddenly an angel touched him. The angel told him, "Get up and eat." Then he looked, and there at his head was a loaf of bread baked over hot stones and a jug of water. And so he ate and drank and lay down again. And then the angel of the Lord returned for a second time and touched him. He said, "Get up and eat, or the journey will be too much for you." So he got up, ate, and drank. And then on the strength of that food, he walked 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the mountain of God. Even though Elijah is running, even though he's going in the wrong direction, even though he should have been standing up against Jezebel and saying, "My God is greater than your gods, and you can't harm me." Instead, he's running, and God still takes care of his servant. God understands what we go through. He's not angry with Elijah or disappointed with Elijah. God understands what Elijah is going through, and he takes care of his servant through it. God sent an angel to strengthen Elijah, to strengthen him enough so that he could run away. It seems kind of strange, doesn't it? God should be stopping Elijah, lecturing him, right? "Elijah, smarten up. Don't you know who I am? This is ridiculous." But instead, he strengthens Elijah to continue to run. I wonder how many times when you look back at your dip, a valley in your life, and everything was going bad, and you look back and you go, "Wow, God was really providing for me there, and I didn't even see it." There have been so many times where I was in a dip and everything was going wrong, and I look back and think, "Wow, God was really moving through that. I didn't see it at the time. I thought everything was falling apart, and yet God was just putting things in place." That could have gone really bad, but it didn't. Or I was feeling terrible, and yet God got another servant to give me a call and encourage me and lift me up. And look how God cares for him, because I think this is actually really important for our mental and spiritual health, and we often overlook it. God provides him with a safe place to sleep. When you're in the dip, if there's any hope of getting out and moving through, we need enough sleep. God has designed us to be able to handle a lot of stress, but then we need to get rest and recover. We actually need sleep. Our bodies need to recover. Secondly, God provides food. We need to take care of our bodies. We need to eat well so that we can function well and think clearly. We need sleep, we need food, and we need to trust in the Lord in all things. So God cares for his servant. And Elijah is strengthened so he can keep on running. And in fact, he's already gone 150 kilometers from where he was. And then he goes another 320 kilometers to the mountain of God. And this is 1 Kings 19, verse 9 and 10. He entered a cave there and spent the night. Suddenly the word of the Lord came to him. And he said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He replied, "I have been very zealous for the Lord God of armies, but the Israelites have abandoned your covenants, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are looking for me to take my life." God's question is a simple one. What are you doing here? What are you doing here? And Elijah starts telling God, as if God doesn't have a clue what's going on in his life. Elijah starts telling God, "God, I've been very zealous for you. And look what's happened. I've done everything you've asked. Now I'm the only one left. I'm all alone." You see, when we're in the dip, the devil wants to blow your dip out of proportion. You're in a dip that's this big, but the devil wants you to think it's this big. It's insurmountable. And we lose sight of who God is. And our problems seem so much bigger. I remember way back when my kids were little, like in the toddler phase, right? And we lived in Edmonton, and so winters were cold, and then spring would happen, and miraculously the grass would come back to life, and things would start growing again. But then the bugs would come back. Every spring, it seemed like our kids forgot what it was like to have bugs flying around. And so they would see a fly and they would start freaking out like it was going to carry them away. And every spring, I had to remind them, "It's just a fly. How big is the fly? It's this big. How big are you? I'm this big. How big is Daddy? Well, he's really big. Do you think Daddy would let anything happen to you? Wouldn't let a fly hurt you?" But sometimes when we're in the dip, we isolate ourselves and our problems, our fly-sized problems, and yet they seem so much bigger. And I understand that sometimes we go through really big dips, relationship breakups, and we lose our job, and we can't pay our bills. And I'm not trying to make light of any of those things. They're serious things. Compared to our God, our living God, these are small things. We're talking about a God who made the universe, who sustains life, who gives us every breath. He is the all-powerful God of the heavens. Luke 12, verse 6 and 7 says, "Aren't five sparrows sold for 2 pennies, yet not one of them is forgotten in God's sight. Indeed, the hairs of your head are all counted. Don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows." Our God made everything right down to the smallest thing, to the last molecule. He is in control of all things. He even knows how many hairs are on your head. But when we're in a dip, we lose all perspective. Forget that we serve a God that just held back the rain for 3 years, that just brought fire from heaven. 1 Kings 19, verse 11. Then he said, go out and stand on the mountain in the Lord's presence. At that moment, the Lord passed by. A great and mighty wind was tearing at the mountains and was shattering cliffs before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake was a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, there was a voice, a soft whisper. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Suddenly a voice came to him and said, what are you doing here, Elijah? Maybe this reminds us of Moses on the mountain. When God showed himself to Moses, Elijah goes out to the opening of the cave and there was a powerful wind. It was so strong it was shattering the rocks and pummeling the mountain, but God wasn't in the wind. That was a warm-up. It was the opening act. And then there was an earthquake, but God wasn't in the earthquake, and it was another pre-game show. There was a fire, and the Lord wasn't in the fire either. And then it says there came a gentle whisper. The literal translation here is a sheer small silence, or a silence that you can hear. Have you ever experienced that? A silence that you can hear? In this silence, God speaks. And after all of this, he asks the same question. What are you doing here, Elijah? What are you doing here? Elijah, back there, I filled you with the power to turn off the rain for 3 years. Back there, I fed you by the birds. I responded to your cries. I raised a boy from the dead at your request. Back there, Elijah, I know you remember this. I filled you with the strength to go against 450 prophets of Baal and rain fire down from heaven at your simple request. What are you doing here? Has God not asked you the same question when you're in the dip? When you feel like God is far away and the temptations are coming at you and the doubt is filling your heart? What are you doing here? Like when you skip church on a Sunday morning because you stayed up too late the night before. And you just couldn't muster the energy to get dressed. Do you ever hear the whisper? What are you doing here? What about when you're surfing the web and you click on a button, and maybe it's even by accident, but you don't click the back button. And God whispers, what are you doing here? Or you've had a rough week and you were really stressed out and you feel like God isn't even real anymore, and you go to the bar to blow off some steam. What are you doing here? Maybe you're at a movie that you know you shouldn't be watching, filling your mind with garbage. What are you doing here? You're reading a romance novel that you know is inappropriate for a follower of Jesus to read. What are you doing here? And we try to rationalize it, and we have all of the excuses lined up, and we have all the lines rehearsed. God, you don't understand. Oh, poor me. I can't help it. It's not my fault. God, if you hadn't have done that, then it would, everything would be okay. God, you don't understand what I'm going through. I'm all alone here. Yeah, because you isolated yourself from the support network of God's people. Yeah, even in COVID, we have groups meeting online that you can be a part of. And instead of remembering the past and the faithfulness of God and trusting God to get him through this, Elijah runs from the problems and he tries to hide and he comes up with excuses. But God comes to him and says, what are you doing here? And after hearing out Elijah's excuses one more time, God gives Elijah this instruction. This is verse 15 to 18. Then the Lord said to him, Go and return by the way you came to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive, you are to anoint Hazael as king over Aram. You are to anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, as king over Israel, and Elisha, son of Shaphat, from Abel-Meholam, as prophet in your place. Then Jehu will put to death whoever escapes the sword of Hazael, and Elijah will put to death whoever escapes the sword of Jehu. But I will leave 7,000 in Israel, every knee that has not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him. Now, don't get lost in all of those names. Here's what the Lord is telling Elijah. Elijah, go back where you were. You're going to go anoint the next king. You're going to go and anoint your successor. And by the way, I know you said you're alone, but there are 7,000 who haven't bowed their knee to Baal. You're not alone. And God gives Elijah this revelation. And you can imagine Elijah's response of, oh, you mean, God, you had a plan? Yeah, I had a plan, Elijah. You mean you already have the next king in mind to defeat the evil that's in our land? Yeah. Yeah, I do. You mean you already have my retirement plan in place? Yeah. You mean you have everything under control? Yeah, I do. For us today, we might say, you mean God, you had a plan to forgive us our sins so we could come back to you? Yeah, it was Jesus. You mean Jesus Christ has freed us from the power and the grip of sin? Yes. You mean the Holy Spirit has filled us with power and redeemed us and set us free from all of this? Yes. Now trust me and come back to me and stop digging. Listen for my voice. Move through the dip into the presence of God. Go back the way you came, Elijah. Stop digging. Trust me. Return to the power that I gave you. Return to where I called you to be. Your work is not done yet. I have a plan for you, and it doesn't involve Jezebel killing you. So stop worrying about that. You're running from her, but she's a side character. This is my story. I'm the one in control. Psalm 23, verse 4 says, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, God intends for us to walk through our valleys. So many times we just keep digging. We isolate ourselves. We run. We start to dwell in the valley. Every valley is located between two mountains. And our God not only cares for us when we're on the mountaintop, but when we're in the valley as well. And he has a plan for us and a victory for us over the next crest of the hill. If you're in the dip today, if you feel like God is a million miles away, and maybe you used to feel his presence, but now you just don't know, stop digging. Trust in the living God. Listen for that still small voice. What are you doing here? Go back the way you came. Back to where I called you to be. Back to my arms. Come back to the power of life in Jesus Christ. Stop being distracted by these fears and threats. Remember who your God is. Remember his past faithfulness. Trust in the living God and respond to his calling. Go back the way you came. I have a plan for you. Elijah was one of the greatest prophets in the Old Testament, and yet look at the dip that he got stuck in. But God is calling us back. Like he did for Elijah. If Elijah goes through these dips, we all will. But when you hit the dip, stop digging. Trust in the living God. And come back to the Savior, to our Lord Jesus Christ, so that he can move you through the dip and into his peace just over the crest of the next hill. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that your word speaks to us. We thank you for stories like this, a great man in Elijah who, like us, goes through a dip. After all of the things that he saw you do, he still goes through a faith crisis, an emotional valley. And yet, God, you worked through that. God, you loved him and cared for him enough to provide for him in the valley and to move him through the valley, to show him that you had a plan, to show him that you know all things and you provided for him. Father, there are so many times in our lives where we go into a dip and yet we just keep digging and we get stuck in the dip and we forget who you are and we can't see yesterday's mountaintops because all we can see is the darkness of the valley. And so God, help us to move through the valley, to see who you are, to see your greatness, to see your love. In your name we pray.
Held in your hands from the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God.
to thank you for joining us this morning. I want to encourage you as we go through the week. If you feel like you're in the dip, think about all of the things that God has done. Think of His Word. Seek after Him. Remember to trust in who He is. He has a plan for you. He wants you to move through the dip into His goodness. So as we pray and as we seek His face, allow Him to move through you, to ask the question, what are you doing here? So we can move back to where He wants us to be. Father, we just thank you again. We praise your name. May your glory shine. May you lift us up out of the valley over the next mountaintop. Amen. Thank you for being here this morning.